Hello! You have maybe seen how we recently struggled to decide which huge and impressive generative model we would like to cover next on the channel. Should it be DALL-E 2 from OpenAI that can generate or edit images from just text? Or rather the slightly boring news about a new largest large language model called Pathways Language Model, or short PaLM, from Google AI? We suppose you already guessed from the title of this video that we decided to go for PaLM. We did not choose DALL-E 2 for the moment because we released a video about diffusion models and Glide way too recently to deal again with that just now. Maybe later, so subscribe. In this video, we will summarize the PaLM paper for you. It's only 83 pages long. And we will explain what is so interesting about this boring large language model, PaLM. Spoiler, it can explain jokes. But Miss Coffee Bean, it's not only about the jokes, is it? But first, let's thank Weights & Biases for supporting us for this video. How many times did you crack a hard problem and wanted to show your solution to someone? Well, Weights & Biases reports have got you covered. If all your insights are in a particular chart, you can share it in a report with a couple of quick comments. But if you have more to show, reports can also do a long form, more polished piece of analysis. Just check out this report about DALL-E Mini. It's like a blog post but on steroids. Reports can help you keep apart the things you want to share and rather not share. You can use reports as a dashboard for reporting a smaller subset of metrics than the main Weights & Biases workspace, but you can also create private shareable links or public view-only links and share it with anyone. Go to 1db.me/ai-coffee-break to see more about how reports can help you quickly share your work with colleagues around the world. Now, back to boring large language models. When it comes to large language models, we have been bored lately. We have been bored by GLAM from Google AI, which has a total of 1.2 trillion parameters. But don't be that impressed. The model works a lot with sparsity, so it activates only 97 billion parameters at a time, which is only 8% of the capacity of the whole model. And on the sparse model landscape with trillions of parameters, we could also count WuDAO 2.0 of 1.75 trillion parameters, or Google's Switch Transformers of 1.6 trillion parameters. But let's take a look at dense models, shall we? We have been bothered by Lambda from Google AI, which is a 137 billion parameter model specialized on dialogue. Then with Gopher from DeepMind of 280 billion parameters. And let's not forget the largest monolithic model so far, called Megatron Turing Energy from Microsoft and Nvidia, with 530 billion parameters. Okay, and of course Google needed to claim the biggest model again, so they made PaLM just a bit bigger, just enough to overshadow Megatron by 10 billion parameters. So yeah, they made a 540 billion parameter model, and keep in mind that this is a dense model. All parameters are used during inference, there's no sparsity here. In terms of model architecture, PaLM does not innovate. It is a GPT-like dense transformer decoder. The beginning of the text goes in, the transformer predicts the next word while attending to the previous words. The authors do use some tricks for training this beast. For example, they are computing attention and the feedforward layer in parallel, which is what people from Eleuther AI have been doing with GPT-J6B. For example, PaLM also uses Swigloo activations, rotary positional embeddings, and a special lossless vocabulary to account for many languages in the training data, for code, and for numbers. These things have already been proven to help train large language models by previous work, and PaLM's innovation is completely geared towards training this beast efficiently. Now, what does it mean efficiently for Google? It certainly does not mean the same as it means for you. When you are happy when you parallelize your GPU training on your 4 GPUs your cluster node has. For Google, this means, and I hope you are seated, that they used 6,144 TPU chips for training. Wow, just for comparison, the most impressive numbers so far were established for Megatron Turing NLG on 2,240 A100 GPUs and for Gopher, which went up to 4,096 TPU version 3 chips. So how does it work? How can Miss Coffee Bean train on 6,144 TPU chips too? Well, she can't, but Google could, because they used two TPU version 4 pods with 3,072 chips each with fast intercommunication. Each pod should have a full copy of the model parameters partitioned over the 3,072 chips. Now, to let the two pods communicate efficiently, the authors used the Pathways system, which was introduced by Google in a previous paper. In a nutshell, a batch of training data is divided into half, and each half is sent to each pod for forward and backward propagation. Then the gradients on half the batch are transferred to the other pod and vice versa. But this also means that the transfer must wait until the other pod finishes, and when the waiting is complete, a burst in data transfer of 81 terabytes per second happens at a time. But you can imagine that all this waiting means that in this time, the cores cannot really compute interesting stuff. It's really impressive how, through a lot of engineering tricks Miss Coffee Bean has no idea about, the authors achieved an analytically computed hardware flops utilization of over 50%, which is impressive and unprecedented. By the way, hardware flops utilization basically measures the time in which the hardware is not idle or waiting for something, but really compute something interesting. In this table comparing Palm to previous large language models, you can see a flops utilization of 46.2%, so smaller than 57.8% in the caption. This is because in the table you can find the flops utilization without rematerialization. Rematerialization means that one saves memory by not storing some intermediate activations, but by recomputing them when needed. This means that with this whole recomputing in rematerialization, the chips are busier when training Palm than the other models are, which are not using the trick. So for comparability, you can see the number in the table without rematerialization. We see how high this is nonetheless, a lot higher than for the comparable inefficient GPT-3 model, for example. Okay, we get it. This thing is big, it's training fast, so what is it eating exactly? Well, it's feeding off lots and lots of training data. On 780 billion tokens, to be exact. 50% of the data consists of social media conversations in multiple languages. Almost a quarter of the data consists of filtered web pages, then books, Wikipedia news, and code. So already from the training data, we assume that Palm will have multilingual abilities and will be able to do code completion. It used 196 gigabytes of source code in Java, HTML, JavaScript, Python, PHP, C#, XML, C++, and C. And surprise, surprise, the model can do code completion, fix compilation errors, translate code from one programming language into the other, even though its pre-training dataset contained 50 times less code than Codex 12b did, which is a dedicated code completion language model. The hypothesis here is that Palm can do code completion even though only 5% of its training data consisted of code, because it benefits from its size and its training on natural language. This natural language training makes it more data efficient when it comes to code data. On natural language, Palm improves state-of-the-art on common benchmarks, like natural language inference, where one has to say whether a sentence entails or contradicts another, reading comprehension, question answering, and even on the complicated Vinograd-style schemas, and so on. But we did not even get to the jaw-dropping part yet. Google had previously organized the collection of Big Bench, which stands for Beyond the Imitation Game Benchmark, which contains quite the tricky tasks like delivering persuasive arguments for false statements or finding the Russian proverb closest in meaning to a given English proverb. Big Bench is quite the crazy collection of tasks, where even the average human has a 50% success rate. Well, by scaling Palm from 8 billion to 62 billion to 500 billion parameters, we see how Palm in few-shot learning surpasses the average human. One word here. Maybe you are wondering what few-shot learning means. Well, I remember a time when few-shot learning could also mean that one trains a model further on 10, maybe 100 samples and updates the parameters of the model while doing so, with the feedback from these few examples. Of course, catastrophic forgetting is a huge problem here, and the updates on the little data can undo what a lot of training have previously done. But there were parameter updates through gradients. But since GPT-3, what we have just described is rather called fine-tuning, and the default meaning of few-shot learning has shifted to something else. The model receives a couple of solved examples as a prompt, which is pre-appended to the input. So we have problem, solution, then problem. And then the GPT-like model completes the sequence with the correct examples as input. Since GPT-3, we have been used to expect large language models to be sensitive to this kind of prompting and give right answers even without having any updates done on them. And we are a bit wondering why this is called few-shot learning when there are no updates and there's no feedback loop in case the model answered incorrectly. Like, where is the learning? But we do not want to start a discussion about what learning means now. We just wanted to make the point that few-shot learning, as we see it from GPT-3 onwards, is just glorified pattern completion. Now, with Palm in this few-shot learning setting, there are 6 tasks where we can observe a discontinuous improvement with scale, so a certain size where the model suddenly gets it with enough parameters. With enough scale, the capability of solving logical sequences just emerges. Is this understanding? I have no idea. But with English proverbs, Miss Coffee Bean would assume that enough parameters are enough to memorize the proverbs. No idea, honestly. I wonder if there is anybody in this world understanding what kind of understanding happens in these models. We observe these discontinuous jumps, but do we really know why they happen? Honestly, no. And speaking of emergence and reasoning, just look, another emergence from model scale and data happens. If one gives a reasoning example to Palm, then Palm reasons too. The authors call this chain of thought prompting. Palm gets as input a question, its answer, and the reason. Then for the next question, the model will follow the pattern and give a reason to its answer too. Incredible! Following the same idea of prompting, where the output is a completion of the given examples, Palm can also explain jokes. But keep in mind, it can do so because its input is an example of an explained joke and a new joke. This makes the joke explanation example in the blog post, which was circulated on social media, a little bit misleading because it omits to show the prompt. You decide how much cherry picking has gone into these examples because we know from playing with GPT-3-like models that they sometimes succeed incredibly and sometimes they fail gracelessly. So, be excited. These emergent capabilities are indeed impressive coming from a slightly conscious, slightly boring language model. But also, keep in mind that there are experiments in the paper evaluating fairness and biases that highlight several problems of the model, reinforcing biases and exhibiting toxicity. There is a lot we do not understand about these models, like why do the bad things, such as toxicity, keep happening? We don't even know why the good things are happening. Okay, we know that scales enables the emergence of some key capabilities in the model, like we have seen with Palm and logical reasoning. But in the open questions of the paper, we can also see a discussion about a possible alternative to sheer model scale, which is the effect of having lots of high-quality training data. So high quality data could be an alternative to large parameter numbers. That's one take. The other take that this could also mean that Palm, with its 540 billion parameters, would learn even more from more high quality training data, so that we haven't even seen the limit yet. What do you think about this paper? On the one hand, the model shows impressive capabilities. But on the other hand, it's boring. There is no architectural innovation in it. But you can imagine that while we did not see the model innovation just yet, now that Google knows how to train these things efficiently on 6,144 TPU chips at once, we will see more research and innovation with large models on text, but also on images, video, audio, you name it. So this is, in a sense, just the beginning. And we're living in exciting times, and I do not even start to say how a little PhD student feels about this. I mean, how do you feel about realizing over and over again that Sutton's bitter lesson is really a thing and that scaling up is the way to go? Or at least one of the ways. See you next time.
Okay, bye.